The Ghost Mountain Boys, their epic march and the terrifying battle for New Guinea, the forgotten war of the South Pacific, by James Campbell. Narrated by Stephen Hoye. Copyright 2007 by James Campbell. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Crown Publishers, an imprint of the Crown Publishing Group, a division of Random House, Inc., and was produced in the year 2007 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. New Guinea was an unlikely place in which to wage a war for world domination. It was an inhospitable, only cursorily mapped, disease-ridden land. Almost no one, not the elite units of the Japanese forces that invaded New Guinea's north coast in July 1942, not the Australian Imperial Forces or its militia, and maybe least of all the U.S. Army's 32nd Red Arrow Division, was prepared for what military historian Eric Bergerud calls some of the harshest terrain ever faced by land armies in the history of the war. In New Guinea, exhaustion and disease pushed armies to the breaking point. Losses to malaria alone were crippling. 67% of the 14,500 American troops involved in the battles for Buna and Senananda contracted the disease. On the Senananda front, casualties due to malaria were over 80%. The suffering was enormous on all sides. For the Americans, it could have been alleviated, at least initially, by better planning. But eventually, the topography and climate would still have exacted a terrible toll. By the time the Red Arrow men arrived in New Guinea in September 1942, U.S. Marine troops were already fighting a brutal, well-documented land battle at Guadalcanal in the Solomon Islands. The Marines had a superbly oiled publicity machine that kept them in the spotlight. The 32nd Division's soldiers fighting in New Guinea felt forgotten. The American public in particular suffered from the misperception that, except for Guadalcanal, the South Pacific was a naval war with a few insignificant ground operations thrown in for good measure. By October 1944, they knew that General Douglas MacArthur, who had fled the Philippines, had returned 2.5 years later, keeping his promise. But they had little idea of what went on in the interim, which is to say that they had scant knowledge of the land war in New Guinea. Americans' lack of interest revealed a geographical ignorance. The European front, and the exception of Guadalcanal, they could comprehend. The vast blue Pacific with its obscure island nations remained a mystery. Yet the fighting on the island of New Guinea, especially the early confrontations at Buna and Senananda, was every bit as fierce as that at Guadalcanal. General Robert Eichelberger, who would assume command of the 32nd, wrote that in New Guinea, everything favored the enemy. Casualties at Buna, in fact, were considerably higher than at Guadalcanal. On Guadalcanal, 1,100 troops were killed and 4,350 wounded. The cost of New Guinea's combined Buna-Senananda-Gona campaign was 3,300 killed and 5,500 wounded. As William Manchester points out in his book American Caesar, if the difference in the size of attacking forces is taken into account, the loss of life on Papua New Guinea had been 3 times as great as Guadalcanal's. On New Guinea, as at Guadalcanal, topography determined everything. Tanks and artillery, which won the day in Europe, were rendered useless. In the matted jungles, men were forced to fight battles at point-blank range. Soldiers used anything that worked, grenades, fixed bayonets, and sometimes their hands. Eric Bergerud described the struggle as a knife fight out of the Stone Age. George Johnston, an Australian war correspondent, called it one of the most merciless and most primeval battles. As fierce as the fighting was, the terrain and climate were just as dangerous. General Hugh Casey, MacArthur's chief engineer, called New Guinea the ultimate nightmare country. Support units, he said, would face challenges without precedent in American military history. Before his first inspection of the island, he assumed that nothing could compare with Bataan and Samar, but New Guinea was in a class of its own. War, Casey told MacArthur, would be almost impossible to wage on the island. His warnings proved prescient. For the troops of the 32nd Division, New Guinea became the ultimate nightmare country indeed. Leonard Sill would later say, all who were alive were so near death. Our briefing, before we began near Port Moresby, did not prepare us for what we were about to encounter. In the beginning, we were all young, healthy GIs, eager to conquer the world. In a matter of weeks, long before we met the enemy force, all of us had been transformed into ghosts of our former selves. Bob Hartman of Grand Rapids, Michigan, minces no words. If I owned New Guinea and I owned hell, I would live in hell and rent out New Guinea. The first time Carl Smestad saw the San Ananda battlefront, he was convinced that it would be his graveyard. God help us, he thought. We're never going to get out of here alive. One would think that the 32nd must have been a division of elite fighters, or that it contained units of crack troops. Nothing could have been further from the truth. Although field service regulations specified all troops must be thoroughly acclimated before initiating operations, the men of the 32nd were not ready for the jungle. When it came time to send the division to New Guinea, a commanding general judged it soft and just barely fit for combat. New to jungle warfare, the division lacked even the basics for survival, prompting one military historian to label the soldiers of the 32nd the guinea pigs of the South Pacific. Men were not issued any of the specialized clothing that later became de rigueur for the war in the South Pacific. For camouflage, their combat fatigues were hastily dyed before they left Australia. In the rain and extreme humidity, the dye ran and clogged the cloth, causing men to develop horrible skin ulcers. Soldiers were forced to wade through vines, creepers, brush, dense stands of razor-sharp kunai grass, and elephant grass as high as a basketball rim without the aid of machetes. They did not even have insect repellent, astonishing when one considers that they were fighting in a bug-ridden place. They were not equipped with waterproof containers either. Matches were often unusable. Quinine and vitamin pills, salt, and chlorination tablets got wet and crumpled in their pants pockets. Never, perhaps, have American troops been more poorly equipped. Yet in New Guinea, the 32nd Division was asked to do the extraordinary. Prologue. Dearest lover, is it ever grand out? You know, honey, you've read in stories about the tropical evenings, a warm, sultry night with a slight breeze, and a moon peeking through the clouds. Well, that's the way it was tonight. I stood there for a long time, watching and most of all wishing to have you standing alongside of me, and that we could really take advantage of the romantic atmosphere. The stillness of the night. Just two things missing. First, and most of all, my Mandy. And then some sweet, faint dance music. Well, we'll just have to postpone it for the present. Until another night. Give Muriel and Anne my love. I think about you all so often. What a great day it will be when we can be together again. Goodbye, sweetheart. All my heart's love, always. Yours forever, Sam. Thursday night, 6 p.m., July 30th, 1942. My sweetheart. And how's my Mandy this evening? Let me see, right now it is 3 o'clock in the morning in Grand Rapids, so you should be sound asleep. Wish I could tiptoe in on you right at this moment, honey, and take a peep in at you. I'd carefully put a kiss on your lips, your cheeks, your eyes, and your hair, and then rest my cheek against yours for a while without awakening you, then take a good long look at you again and tiptoe out. Yours forever, Sam. Wednesday night, 7:50 p.m., September 9th, 1942. To my one and only. I'll try my best to get my thoughts on paper, but it's not like being with you, darling. Sitting across from you, watching the smile on your face, the touch of your legs under the table. I miss you, love. Oh, God, how I miss you sometimes. All these things I've wanted to tell you, should have told you before I left. I hope you don't think I'm sacrilegious, but if I were offered my choice between heaven and you, I'd choose you. I'm going to say goodbye now. Always your man, Sam. Later that night. Hello, darling. Here I am again. I hope the censors will let that letter go through all right. I started out to write this letter, but wrote that one instead. I have hopes they, the censors, won't open the previous letter. Certainly no military secrets in there, unless it's a military secret that I'm so very, very much in love with you. I'm sure, though, that the Japs don't care about that. Wednesday night, 8 p.m., somewhere in New Guinea, October 14th, 1942. Dearest lover, October 14th. This is the eve of 2 years in the Army. 2 years ago tomorrow we were inducted. I've been under the weather a little of late, been having a little dysentery. There are an enormous amount of flies here. I suppose you wonder all about New Guinea. There are a lot of natives here. Quite a bit of sickness and disease amongst the natives. They have a lot of skin diseases and eye infections. A lot of the small children walk about with pot bellies due to malnutrition. Pretty near all have rickets. Some have large spleens because of malaria. The men folks wear a cloth about the hips. The women folks wear a tropical grass skirt. The other day I saw a woman nursing a baby on one breast and a small pig on the other. The natives are very much tattooed. They make wonderful boatsmen. Night before last, crossed a fast-streaming river, and two of these natives handled a boat and took us right straight across like nothing. The women seem to do much of the work. We'll see a native carrying a spear coming down a path, and behind him comes his wife, all loaded down with fruit, coconuts, wood, etc., on her back and head, and perhaps a baby sitting on top of that holding onto her hair. What I'm really looking forward to is the day I step on U.S. soil. What a day that will be. Good night, my Mandy. Lovingly yours, Sam. Monday night, New Guinea, November 2nd, 1942. Dear Muriel, and how's that big daughter of mine getting along? I've been wondering about you so much now that you are going to school. Mommy tells me you are a big girl now. How nice you play with Anne. Do you like your baby brother? I sure miss you, Muriel. Remember how you and I used to play at night in the house before you went to bed? That was loads of fun, wasn't it? I'm thinking lots about you. Love, your dad. Late November 1942, Buna Coast, New Guinea. Before setting out, they smeared their faces with green paint. Loaded down with hand grenades, 30 and 40 caliber ammunition, and 2 days' rations, the Americans struggled through heavy jungle and dug in just in front of a battalion of Australians. A second American detachment had its sights set on a spot farther north along the trail. Navigating through hip-deep swamps, the soldiers clashed with a Japanese patrol, lost their bearings, and ended up well short of their destination. Having realized that the main advance was falling apart, another company left the banana plantation and pushed forward in a northwesterly direction through nipa and sago palm. 200 yards out, it was stopped in its tracks by heavy Japanese crossfire. Ordered to dig in, the men worked fast. They had just settled into their trenches when the Japanese attacked. Hundreds of enemy troops bore down on them. They rushed forward like wild Indians, shouting "Banzai!" crashing through the jungle, their bayonets drawn. The Americans froze. The Japanese soldiers were almost upon them when the Americans finally fired. The forest filled with the smell of gunpowder. Called forward, two Australian companies hurried to help, and together they drove back the Japanese, inflicting heavy losses. At night, as their foxholes filled with water, the soldiers listened to swamp rats feeding on corpses. 3 days later, having patrolled the area and drawn up rudimentary maps, the Americans again prepared to attack. They opened up with artillery and mortars and then moved forward. One detachment pushed straight north, followed by a platoon of Australians and the regimental surgeon, Major Simon Sam Warmenhoven, and a portion of his staff. To avoid the swamp, the soldiers clung to the main trail. 100 yards out, they slammed into the Japanese and were halted by a torrent of fire. When a mortar landed among the Australians, Major Warmenhoven ran forward, dashing past enemy fire lanes. Five men lay dead. Another eight were alive, but the shrapnel had done its work. They were badly torn up. Warmenhoven jumped from one man to the next as mortars exploded around him. He gave each soldier a half grain of morphine, cut away their clothes, and dusted their wounds with sulfanilamide powder. Then he dressed the wounds as best he could and waited with the moaning soldiers for litter-bearers to arrive. Later he would receive the Distinguished Service Cross for his heroism. Book One. Thus it was they wrought our woe at the tavern long ago. Tell me, do our masters know, loosing blindly as they fly, old men love while young men die? Rudyard Kipling. Chapter 1. Escape to the South. On the night of March 11, 1942, Douglas MacArthur was preparing to flee the island of Corregidor, headquarters of the Allied forces in the Philippines. Only 15 miles across the North Channel, his army was trapped on the jungle-clothed Philippine peninsula of Bataan. MacArthur, his wife, his 4-year-old son, Arthur, Arthur's Cantonese ama, 13 members of MacArthur's staff, 2 naval officers, and a technician gathered at the destroyed Corregidor dock. Corregidor rose dramatically from the waters of Manila Bay. What had once been a luxuriant green island was now a devastated, crater-ridden monument to the fury of the battle for the Philippines. Major General Jonathan Skinny Wainwright emerged from the shadows.
"Jonathan," MacArthur said, "I want you to understand my position very plainly. I'm leaving for Australia pursuant to repeated orders of the President. I want you to make it known throughout all elements of your command that I'm leaving over my repeated protests. If I get through to Australia, you know I'll come back as soon as I can with as much as I can. In the meantime, you've got to hold."
Wainwright assured MacArthur that he would do everything in his power to hold Bataan. He wiped the tears from his eyes, and MacArthur's jaw quivered. Then MacArthur composed himself and shook Wainwright's hand.
"When I get back, if you're still on Bataan, I'll make you a lieutenant general."
Wainwright said simply, "I'll be on Bataan if I'm alive." MacArthur's long personal crusade to return to the Philippines in victory had begun. Lieutenant John Buck Bulkley, a naval commander, had already inspected the 4 escape crafts, mahogany-hulled PT boats, 77 feet from bow to stern, powered by big Packard engines. That said, the PT boats were still risky. After 3 months of combat, the engines were overused. The boats were fast, but not fast enough to outrun enemy destroyers. To make matters worse, the party would have to travel hundreds of miles over poorly charted waters, using only a compass, crude maps, and dead reckoning. MacArthur, though, could not be dissuaded from his plan. He had already refused to go by submarine. Getting a sub to Corregidor would simply take too much time, time MacArthur did not have. Besides, he loved the PT boat, and that was how he wanted to leave the Philippines. The Japanese Navy was watching for him, and MacArthur understood the implications. His wife and child were aboard Bulkley's boat with him, and Tokyo Rose had been broadcasting threats. If captured, MacArthur would be hanged in public in Tokyo's Imperial Plaza. The Japanese, though, would never take him alive. He had 2 highly polished derringers and 2 cartridges that he planned to use as a last resort. It was a moonlit night, and as the boats moved toward Mindoro, south of Corregidor, Lieutenant Bulkley felt a growing apprehension. They were nearing the Japanese blockade. Pummeled by strong easterly winds, the seas churned, and visibility was poor. MacArthur, Arthur, and Arthur's nurse lay below, miserably seasick. Arthur was running a fever, and MacArthur retched violently. Though also sick, MacArthur's wife Jean tended to both her son and her husband. In the rough seas, the boats became separated, and from that point on, it was every crew for itself. One of the 4 PT boats reached the rendezvous point in the Cuyo Islands and waited in the morning mist for the arrival of the others. Suddenly, the commander of the first boat sighted what he thought was a Japanese destroyer speeding toward them. He ordered 500 gallons of gasoline jettisoned and pushed down on the throttles. Still, the other ship gained on them. Realizing he could not get away, the commander reversed course and readied the torpedoes for firing. He was prepared to give the order when he recognized the oncoming ship as Bulkley's vessel. After the near mishap, MacArthur and his party waited for the third PT boat. The fourth boat had broken down en route. It was a hot, sultry day, and they bobbed like castaways on the water, among the sandy coves and palm-fringed volcanic islands. 2 hours later, the third PT boat limped into the inlet. MacArthur now had an important decision to make. The plan was to meet the submarine permit. At that point, they had to choose, submarine or PT boat. MacArthur was tempted to travel the rest of the way by submarine, but Bulkley pointed out that Tagwayan, where they were to assemble, was 3 hours away and that they would never be able to get there in time. MacArthur was getting antsy. Knowing that there would be planes waiting to transport them to Australia, MacArthur decided to make directly for Mindanao in two of the original four PT boats. Less than an hour after leaving, MacArthur heard the lookout shout, "Looks like an enemy cruiser!" Bulkley drew in a deep breath when he saw the faster warship's imposing outlines. Then he calmed himself and waited for the inevitable. But the inevitable never came. The seas were rough, and the PT boats lay low in the water, surrounded by whitecaps, and skidded by the cruiser without being spotted. Hours later, in the waning light of the afternoon, they saw the hulking silhouette of a Japanese warship. They cut their engines and hoped they would be mistaken for native fishing vessels. The ruse worked. They had averted disaster. Again. On a clear night, illuminated by the moon, they continued across the Mindanao Sea, bound for Cagayan, on Mindanao's north coast. When they arrived at the Del Monte Cannery in Cagayan in the early morning of March 13th, they knew that they had slipped through the Japanese blockade. But now the group faced another potential disaster. The plan had been to reach Cagayan by water and then to fly directly to Darwin on Australia's north coast. However, as MacArthur watched one war-weary B-17 land, he grew furious and refused to let anyone board. He had expected four reliable planes, not one dilapidated B-17. For nearly 4 days, MacArthur and his party risked discovery while his commander of American forces in Australia tried to secure Navy planes. Everyone was tense, especially Major General Richard Sutherland, MacArthur's chief of staff. Sutherland fumed that they were sitting ducks. A Philippine informant could easily betray them to the Japanese, who were on the south end of the island and regularly patrolled north. On the evening of March 16th, two of the Navy's best flying fortresses landed. Hours later, as the two bombers crossed the Celebes Sea, enemy fighters appeared out of the darkness. Terror swept through the plains. Had they made it this far only to be gunned down by enemy pilots? They could do only one thing, continue to fly their course. As they watched, the Zeros inexplicably turned back. Then MacArthur knew that they had finally escaped. When the Flying Fortresses landed 40 miles south of Darwin at Bachelor Field, two DC-3s were waiting to transport the group to Melbourne. However, MacArthur refused to fly. His wife had been very sick on the flight, and out of concern for her, he did not want to board another plane. What eventually convinced him not to travel by train was his son's condition. Arthur remained very ill. His doctor did not think that he could make the long overland journey. After considerable discussion, MacArthur finally agreed to fly. When they landed in Alice Springs to refuel, the rest of the crew went by air to South Australia. MacArthur, though, insisted now on traveling by train. But the one that serviced Alice Springs had left the previous day, so arrangements had to be made to bring in a special train. When it arrived the next day, MacArthur, his wife and son, the Ama, and General Sutherland boarded. For 3.5 days and over 1,000 miles, the slow, narrow-gauge train chugged through the vast, sun-scorched Australian outback to Adelaide. Nearing the city, MacArthur's deputy chief of staff boarded the train and delivered a wrenching blow. The general would not lead a great army against the Japanese. In fact, he would be fighting a shoestring campaign. Months before, Roosevelt and Churchill had met in Washington, D.C., and together they settled on a Germany-first policy, determining that the Atlantic European Theater would be the main focus of operations. MacArthur was nearly speechless at the news. "God have mercy on us," was all he could say. Approaching Adelaide, MacArthur was forced to compose himself. At the station, the gathered reporters were eager to know. He had fled the Philippines, yet his men were still there fighting. Did he have anything to say? MacArthur was tired and still distraught from Sutherland's news, a lonely, angry man, according to his wife. But he wanted to send a message to his army and the people of the Philippines to let them know that they would not be forgotten. It was then that he delivered his famous words, "The President of the United States ordered me to break through the Japanese lines and proceed for Corregidor to Australia for the purpose, as I understand it, of organizing the American offensive against Japan, a primary object of which is the relief of the Philippines. I came through, and I shall return." On March 18th, a day after he arrived in Australia, MacArthur learned the whole truth of America's Germany First policy. His U.S. ground troops would be limited to two divisions. He protested to General Marshall, "No commander in American history has so failed of support as here." MacArthur already felt as if Roosevelt had betrayed him in the Philippines. Now he felt betrayed again. His hope for a quick victory against the Japanese in New Guinea evaporated. When MacArthur came to Australia, not only did he not have a great army to lead, but he was being asked to protect a country that was powerless to protect itself. In a show of extreme loyalty, Australia had sent its land, sea, and air forces to join England in its fight against the European Axis in Africa, Greece, and the Middle East. Australia's national security and 12,000 miles of its coastline were left to the Australian militia, a group of poorly trained, poorly equipped home guardsmen. Australian officials feared that Japan would invade, and the Australian press shamelessly fueled these fears. Thousands of Sydney residents fled the city for the Blue Mountains 50 miles to the west. People in Darwin, Cairns, and Townsville abandoned their homes. A month before MacArthur arrived in Australia, the country's growing sense of vulnerability became a reality. Japanese planes bombed Darwin, killing 250 people and destroying 9 ships and 20 aircraft. A feeling of paranoia seized Australia. The Japanese had roared through Hong Kong, Malaya, Guam, Rabaul, Singapore, Java, the Dutch East Indies, and Burma. Eventually, what Japan would call its Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere would cover the entire coastline of Asia, extending from Manchuria to Rangoon, and would include the Pacific in a line running south from the Aleutian Islands. It would occupy 1/6 of the Earth's surface. The Australians feared they were next. On February 3rd, Japan bombed Port Moresby, New Guinea's largest city, for the first time. By early March, Japanese forces occupied Salamaua and Lae, two cities that were part of Australia's New Guinea Mandate. The invasion was staged from Rabaul, a small town on the island of New Britain, 400 air miles off the New Guinea mainland, which the Japanese had overwhelmed 1.5 months earlier, despite valiant opposition from the Australian forces garrisoned there. The Japanese transformed Rabaul into their South Sea base. With a magnificent harbor and 2 airfields, Rabaul held one of the largest collections of troops outside of Japan. After the Japanese landed in New Guinea, Allied headquarters in Australia did its best to anticipate Japan's next move. Would Premier Hideki Tojo's army invade Australia? Whatever Japan's plans were, there was no denying the reality. Australia, New Guinea, and the Solomon Islands were the last major positions still left to the Allies in the Southwest Pacific. On February 17, 1942, Army Chief of Staff General George C. Marshall ordered the transfer to Australia of the 41st U.S. Infantry Division. The 41st mission was to protect Australia's ports and air bases and to provide garrisons for the defense of its eastern and northeastern coastal cities. Despite the imminent arrival of the 41st Division, when MacArthur landed in Australia in mid-March 1942, he began lobbying for more troops and more planes and ships, especially aircraft carriers. MacArthur combined his obsession with returning to the Philippines with a suspicion that the political powers in the U.S., especially the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and the demands and influence of the Navy in the Central Pacific were depriving him of the resources he needed to wage a war. Only 9% of U.S. supplies went to the Southwest Pacific. He complained that he was always the underdog and was always fighting with destruction just around the corner. To an extent, MacArthur's fears were justified. MacArthur and the Navy brass were openly hostile to each other. Both lobbied for a finite supply of resources, for which the Navy was often given preference. Australia's Prime Minister John Curtin had been waging his own personal campaign for troops for months and treating Great Britain for its help before MacArthur ever set foot in Australia. Britain, though, had thrown herself full force against the Germans, and Churchill maintained that he did not have the troops to spare. In desperation, Curtin turned to the United States. The day after Pearl Harbor, Curtin allied Australia with the Americans, declaring that Australia was at war with Japan. On December 23, 1941, he wrote to Roosevelt and to Churchill, "Our resources here are very limited. It is in your power to meet the situation. Should the government of the United States desire, we would gladly accept an American commander in the Pacific area." At the same time, Curtin demanded 3 divisions from Australia's Imperial forces sent home at once. When Churchill told him that his request was impossible to fulfill, Curtin persisted and eventually won the return of 2 out of the 3. Churchill argued that to remove the 9th Division from the Middle East would jeopardize the British line. He then suggested to Roosevelt that if the Prime Minister agreed to leave the 9th Division in place, the United States should send to Australia another U.S. Army Infantry Division. Marshall chose the 32nd. A full 7 months later, as the Japanese Imperial Army ascended a high ridge overlooking Port Moresby, MacArthur dispatched 2 of the 32nd Division's 3 regimental combat teams to New Guinea. Although MacArthur came to Australia in defeat, no one would have known it from his reception. One of the most decorated generals of his time, a man who during World War I was called by America's Secretary of War the finest frontline American general of the war, had arrived to defend Australia in her hour of need. In fact, MacArthur's arrival overshadowed the return of one of Australia's own heroes. Curtin had ordered General Sir Thomas Blamey to return home from the Middle East as speedily as possible, appointing him Allied Commander, Australian Military Forces. The March 18th announcement that MacArthur would be the supreme commander of the Southwest Pacific area upstaged Blamey's appointment. Blamey was unhappy about the news, which he got while traveling by train east from Perth. But the Joint Chiefs of Staff had already worked out the organization of the Pacific, dividing the theater into 2 distinct areas. The Pacific Ocean, which included North, Central, and South, went to the Navy. And the Southwest Pacific, including Australia, the Philippines, New Guinea, the Solomons, the Bismarck Archipelago, and a portion of the Dutch East Indies, would go to MacArthur. Conceding to General George Marshall, who argued that an Australian should command Allied troops, MacArthur reluctantly appointed Blamey as his commander Allied land forces. In an uncharacteristic moment of modesty, MacArthur named himself as Commander-in-Chief Southwest Pacific Area, SWPA, rather than Supreme Commander. Despite MacArthur's choice of Blamey, Australian officers were still unhappy. The staff of MacArthur's general headquarters was entirely American, composed of trusted advisers who had served on his staff in the Philippines. Not appointing an Australian as a senior member of his staff, which was known as the Bataan Gang, was a move by MacArthur that generated bad blood between the Commander-in-Chief and the Australians, though it was one he defended gruffly. "There was no prospect," he said, "of obtaining qualified senior staff officers from the Australians." From the beginning, MacArthur regarded Blamey ambivalently. In his words, Blamey was sensual, slothful, and of doubtful moral character, but a tough commander likely to shine like a power light in an emergency. The best of the local bunch. Blamey's opinion of MacArthur was not much different. The best and the worst of the things you hear about him are both true, Blamey said. On a bright sunny morning in March, a train pulling MacArthur's private railroad car came to a stop at Spencer Street Station in Melbourne. 6,000 people, including the Prime Minister and other dignitaries, greeted MacArthur with an outburst of adoration. A correspondent for an Australian newspaper said that he had never seen any man receive such acclaim. MacArthur stepped from the car, and though weary, he was an impressive-looking man. He sported a flourishable cane and wore his signature gold-embroidered cap dashingly at an angle. After a brief but dramatic speech in which he took a jab at Roosevelt for consigning him to Australia to command an insufficient army, MacArthur and Sutherland stepped into a limousine and made for the Menzies Hotel. For the next few days, MacArthur went into hiding, guarded closely by his devoted chief of staff, General Sutherland, trying to come to terms with the reality of his situation. A part of the 32nd Division's fate was sealed when Churchill persuaded Roosevelt to break England's stalemate with Australia by sending Australia another U.S. Army infantry division. The division's ultimate fate, though, hung in the balance for months after MacArthur arrived down under. The defensive strategy devised by the Australian Chiefs of Staff was to hold the Brisbane Line, 1,000 miles of coastline between Brisbane and Melbourne, the heart of the country's industrial power and its population center. Barbed wire was strung along the beaches in Sydney and Melbourne, and a blackout was imposed on the southeast coastal cities. Initially, MacArthur accepted, or was forced to accept, the Australian strategy. Later, though, he wrote that he never had any intention of abiding by what he considered a defeatist approach. He asserted that from the moment he set foot in Australia, he planned to take the war against Japan's Imperial Army to New Guinea. MacArthur considered New Guinea a backwater theater. His decision to engage the Japanese Imperial Army there was a strategic necessity. Japan, on the other hand, coveted New Guinea, one of the last essential pieces in its colossal Asia-Pacific land grab. Once it controlled the island, it could isolate and perhaps invade Australia. More important, possession of New Guinea would allow the Japanese to cut off the 8,000-mile Allied supply line, one of the longest in military history, that ran from the west coast of the United States to Australia via Hawaii and Fiji, thereby ending Allied influence in the South Pacific. MacArthur's decision to fight for New Guinea and Admiral Ernest King's efforts to challenge Japanese expansion in the Solomons by invading Guadalcanal upset Japanese plans for putting a quick end to the war and suing for a favorable peace that acknowledged its numerous conquests. But even as MacArthur prepared to send troops to New Guinea, he bitterly resented its necessity and remained obsessed with the Philippines, vowing to return even if he were down to one canoe paddled by Douglas MacArthur and supported by one Taylor Cub plane. In New Guinea, that pledge would be put to the ultimate test. MacArthur would be up against a Japanese army whose determination to hold the island would initiate one of the South Pacific's most savage campaigns. Chapter 2. A Train Heading West. 3 weeks after MacArthur arrived in Australia, his dream of a speedy return to the Philippines was shattered. Major General Edward King, ignoring MacArthur's orders for a counterattack against the Japanese on Bataan, surrendered to them on April 9, 1942. The capitulation was the largest in U.S. military history. 3 days before the surrender and 10,000 miles away, the 32nd Infantry Division was loaded onto a train. The decision to move the division puzzled battalion and company commanders who had been led to believe that they were headed for the European Theater of Operations, ETO. The rumor was that the division was now bound for the Southwest Pacific. Although many of the 32nd Division's men could not have pointed on a world map to the area defined as the Southwest Pacific, they were familiar with Europe's historic battlefields. Called the Red Arrow, the 32nd Division first distinguished itself in World War I. Because of its exploits, the French gave the 32nd the sobriquet Les Terribles. Its symbol, which it wore proudly as a shoulder patch, was a red arrow piercing a line. It was said that there was not a line the tenacious 32nd could not penetrate. It was the first division to pierce the German army's Hindenburg line, for example. By 1940, though, the 32nd Division's glory was a distant memory. On October 15th that year, when the Fighting 32nd was called to colors in the first peacetime conscription act in American history, it was a largely untrained, loosely organized National Guard unit, comprised mostly of men from Wisconsin and Michigan. In the lean years at the end of the Depression, many jobless young men saw the National Guard as an alternative to poverty. Most felt no special calling or patriotic duty or military ambition. Stanley Jaster Zemsky of Company G, 2nd Battalion, 126th U.S. Infantry, was one of those men. Born and raised in Muskegon, Michigan, he joined the National Guard to help support his family. Jaster Zemsky had the longest name in the company. Jasters Empsky, the men of Company G used to chant jokingly, and at only 16 he was its youngest member. When Germany invaded Poland, Jasters Empsky considered going to Poland and enlisting in the Polish army. He stayed home, however, and to help support his family, he joined the National Guard instead. His immigrant parents were dead, and there were 6 kids living at home. The Jaster Zemsky children tended a garden and traded vegetables with neighbors for chickens and rabbits. There was no money, though, and the family needed the paycheck the guard offered. For Jaster Zemsky, the guard offered just enough money to live on. For others, it provided a small beer and entertainment fund. A guy's local guard unit met one night a week. For that, he received a paycheck of $12 every 3 months. Enough for him to keep food in the house and to take a gal he was sweet on to the picture show. For weekend maneuvers and 3 weeks of summer training, the guard paid extra. Upon having their service extended beyond 1 year, many guardsmen threatened to go AWOL. Ohio was the code word of their rebellion, over the hill in October. But October 15th came and went. The truth was that life in the army was not half bad. Call-up meant 3 meals a day, a roof overhead, a chance to shoot guns, and steady pay. When the 32nd was mobilized in October 1940, it was sent via troop trains to the Deep South, far from its Midwestern roots. The send-off was festive. Units marched to train stations, bands played, and thousands of people lining the parade routes shouted their encouragement. Camp Beauregard, situated at the fringes of Alexandria, Louisiana, was the division's new home. Beauregard, though, was not ready for the 32nd. Built as a National Guard summer camp and equipped to accommodate only 1 regiment, the camp's infrastructure was overwhelmed by the division's 100 officers and 3,200 enlisted men, who promptly dubbed Beauregard Camp Disregard. The tents in which they lived were heated with charcoal, which gave them terrible headaches. And when the cold late fall rains began, the camp, trampled by the boots of thousands of men and the heavy tires of military vehicles, became a mud hole. Jaster Zemsky and the 32nd spent only 4 months at Camp Disregard, but it was a stay plagued by personnel turnover, equipment shortages, and an inadequate training regimen. One guardsman said bluntly, "We fired our rifles, screamed, and ran at straw dummies. That was the extent of our training." Carl Stenberg, a heavy weapons squad leader in Jaster Zemsky's Company G, recalls that the training area at Disregard lay 4 miles from camp. Company G marched out in the morning and back to camp at night. He remembers the sound of metal on metal, of rifles clanking against helmets. "Put it this way," Stenberg says, "we did a lot of marching." On weekends, the men would head for New Orleans, Alexandria, or Natchez, Mississippi, attracted by the promise of music, booze, and women. Despite the occasional outbreak of gonorrhea and the lurid films designed to scare the men into abstinence, the buses from Camp Beauregard deposited them every weekend at the front door of a brothel in Alexandria that they called Ma Bell's. One guardsman, who spent his share of time at Ma Bell's, said that the line of eager young men often ran around the block. In February 1941, the 32nd moved to the newly built Camp Livingston, Louisiana, 10 miles northeast of Alexandria. At Livingston, the division began its transformation, losing its old-time guard officers to overage, being declared too old to serve with combat troops, and bringing on board recent selective service draftees and junior officers from the Reserve Officers Training Corps, ROTC, and Officer Candidate School, OCS. With the infusion of troops, Captain Simon Wormenhoven, formerly the senior resident in surgery at St. Mary's Hospital in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and now one of the doctors in the 126th Infantry Regiment's medical detachment, stayed busy. Wormenhoven was no stranger to hard work. Growing up, he had put in long hours on his father's farm. On summer breaks during college, he ran a 4-horse grain binder and traveled all over cutting wheat for local farmers. His younger brother Cornelius, who helped him by drumming up business, remembers how Simon would make it back to the house well after dark and practically fall asleep at the supper table. Once he got back to college, he shoveled coal into campus furnaces for spending money. The new soldiers needed physicals and vaccinations. After days of marching, they needed help tending to sore feet. Perhaps what they required most was sound medical advice about the dangers of cavorting with the kind of women who made their living at Ma Bell's. Doc Wormenhoven could only do so much, though. These were young men in the prime of their lives, and he was not given to preaching. Regardless of his warnings, the soldiers sowed their wild oats on Friday and Saturday nights and then, as the saying went, attended church on Sundays to pray for crop failure. Wormenhoven, who in his early 30s was practically as old as some of the soldiers' fathers, stayed behind in camp, writing letters to his wife Henrietta, whom he called Mandy. She called him Sam. Wormenhoven was a devoted husband and father and the son of staunchly religious parents. When his parents emigrated to the United States from the Netherlands in 1921, Simon was 11 years old, they chose the community of Sunnyside, Washington. Sunnyside was founded in 1898 as a Christian cooperative colony by members of the German Baptist Progressive Brethren, who selected the beautiful Yakima Valley as the site for their experiment in Christian living. In every land deed it sold, Sunnyside included a morality code: no drinking, dancing, gambling, or horse racing. By the time Wormenhoven was of high school age, his parents sent him off to Hull Academy, a Christian school in Hull, Iowa, where he boarded with the minister's family. Later, with a student loan from the Christian Reformed Church, he attended Calvin College in Grand Rapids, Michigan. He was preparing to enter the seminary, fulfilling his parents' dream, when he signed up for dance lessons and realized that thanks to the church's austere code of conduct, he had been missing out on one of life's great joys. He switched his major to biology, got a Bachelor of Science degree, and later attended medical school at Marquette, a Jesuit university in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. On Sunday, March 9th, 1941, while most of the men were dragging themselves back to camp after boozy weekend jaunts to Alexandria or Natchez or New Orleans, Wormenhoven was listening to the Blue Danube Waltz on the radio and penning a letter to Mandy. Mandy was pregnant with their second child, and as he wrote, Wormenhoven was trying out names, how he hoped to be home for the birth. Livingston was a melting pot of men from all over the Midwest. They came from small towns and farms and industrial cities, from immigrant families separated by only a generation from Poland, Germany, Holland, Italy, Ireland. At first, the guardsmen and the draftees regarded each other skeptically. The draftees, according to the guardsmen, were not real soldiers. The draftees, on the other hand, considered themselves intellectually superior to the guardsmen. Most of the draftees had graduated from high school. Some had even been to college. When they wanted to insult a fellow soldier, they accused him of acting like a guardsman. But gradually, as they lived and trained together, the barriers broke down. One of those new draftees was Samuel DiMaggio. DiMaggio was a first-generation American. His father, Giuseppe, came over from Sicily in 1902 using money that someone had agreed to loan him for the voyage. Having worked for 2 years to pay back his sponsor, Giuseppe traveled back to Sicily to fetch his bride, and after returning began his career as a railroad man in Albion, Michigan, roughly 90 miles west of Detroit. After a few years, he took a job with the largest local employer, Malleable Iron Company, which made parts for automotive manufacturers. Sam DiMaggio was born in 1916 in Albion, on a table in a house owned by the company. Like the Jastrzemskis, the DiMaggios cultivated a large garden in their backyard, growing most of the food they ate. By 14, Sam was working at the Malleable Iron Company in order to pay for school supplies and books. On the night shift, he stoked 50 pot-bellied stoves with coal. It was hard, grimy work. In 1935, he graduated from high school, fulfilling a dream. But the dream ended there, and shortly after, he returned to his old job. In 1941, his life changed forever in the form of a draft notice. He viewed it as the break he had been waiting for. He would put in his year and, in the interim, figure out what he wanted to do with his life. When the gates of the Malleable closed behind him for the last time, DiMaggio glanced back and said, "I'm never coming back here, you son of a bitch." On April 11th, Good Friday, DiMaggio reported to Fort Custer in Battle Creek, Michigan. A few days after Easter, he was on a southbound train without the vaguest idea where that train was headed. 2 days later, he arrived at Camp Livingston, Louisiana. He had never been farther than 10 miles from home. Physically, Camp Livingston was a far cry from Disregard. It was a spacious, thoroughly up-to-date camp with gas heaters in all the tents, heated latrines, bathrooms with an unlimited supply of hot water, washing machines, and raised walkways made of crushed stone or oyster shells. Livingston was a veritable military city with over 14,000 tents, 1,500 buildings, laundries, bakeries, post offices, fire stations, and hospitals. At Livingston, the 32nd's training lacked a sense of urgency. DiMaggio was surprised by how casual it was. First Sergeant Paul Lutyens of the 2nd Battalion's E Company admitted, "No matter how much our officers and non-coms talked about combat, we couldn't help but think they were talking about somebody else." In late summer 1941, the Army initiated the Louisiana Maneuvers, the largest peacetime war games in U.S. history. 400,000 men trained in the unrelenting heat and humidity of the hills, valleys, and pine forests of Louisiana and East Texas. The experience was intended to toughen the men and to develop their skills in the field. With an eye toward the European Theater of Operations rather than the SWPA, the men were trained in modern mechanized mobile warfare that emphasized World War I tactics based on big guns preparing the way for infantry. The maneuvers were considered a great success, though they would have no practical application for the 32nd Division once it arrived in New Guinea, where jeeps, tanks, and trucks were neutralized by a terrain that reduced war to its most primitive. It was not that the opportunities for mimicking New Guinea's conditions did not exist. The swamps of Louisiana were so available, Major Herbert C. Smith, then the 128th Infantry Regiment supply officer, wrote with the clarity of hindsight, but we did not train in them. Had we only known. During the Depression, fathers earned money any way they could, and Alfred Meddendorp was no exception. He had gone to chiropractic school, but after getting his diploma, discovered that he did not enjoy practicing. Then he took a sales job with a biological supply company, peddling test tubes and beakers to universities and high schools around the country. Afterward, he opened up his own business and caught and killed stray cats, embalmed them, and sold them to researchers at the University of Chicago. After joining the National Guard in 1931 for the extra money it offered, he had another commitment, and with federalization 9 years later, the Army became his first responsibility. In winter 1941, Captain Alfred Meddendorp had just arrived home from Camp Livingston on leave to Grand Rapids, Michigan. He had not seen his wife and 3 sons in nearly a year. On Sunday morning, December 7th, he and his boys were traipsing around the hills near the house with bows and arrows, creeping through fields and ducking in and out of woodlots, shooting trees and launching arrows high into the air. Alfred Jr. crept along with his dad, picking his way over dry leaves and sticks. There was no snow, but the ground was frozen. The leaves crumbled like wax paper under their feet. Dot Meddendorp was in the kitchen, tidying up. On the radio, the Glenn Miller Band was playing Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree with Anybody Else But Me, when a newsman's urgent voice interrupted. Dot rushed to the radio to turn up the volume. The Japanese, the newsman reported, had just bombed Pearl Harbor. Dot hurried to the back door and called out, "Al, come quick! Something's happened!" Alfred Meddendorp rushed toward the house, followed by his sons. Dot was standing at the back door, holding it half open. "Japan just bombed," she said, choking on the words. Meddendorp brushed past his wife and sat down at the kitchen table. The voice on the radio repeated, "The Japanese have bombed Pearl Harbor." Meddendorp tried to absorb the impact of the news. Then he looked up to see Al Jr. standing at the door, holding his little bow. Later that day, Meddendorp received a telegram ordering him back to Camp Livingston. The following day, he left. But not before Dot took a family photograph. In the photo, Meddendorp is standing behind his three sons. The low, dun-colored hills that they had wandered the previous morning form the photo's backdrop. His arms encircle the boys. He is in full dress uniform and smiles slightly. The boys, too, are dressed up. Hats, Sunday coats. Al Jr. wears stockings and tucks his hands into the pockets of his checkered black and red peacoat. When Corporal Carl Stenberg heard about Pearl Harbor, he and a bunch of buddies had just come back from Alexandria, Louisiana. It was a weekend ritual for Stenberg. While other soldiers went to Alexandria for the women, the recently married Stenberg made the trip to go to the theater. When Stenberg and his friends returned on Sunday afternoon, the camp was buzzing with activity. Trucks waited, their engines idling, and men rushed from building to building. Even before hearing the news, Stenberg knew that something big was up. It was in the mess hall that he learned what had happened. "The Nips just bombed Pearl Harbor," exclaimed a cook. The following day, fearing the Japanese might follow up Pearl Harbor with attacks on other strategic sites, the entire camp mobilized. The division sent soldiers to guard dry docks, factories, shipyards, bridges, chemical refineries, utilities, and sulfur mines across the South, from Mississippi to Louisiana to East Texas. Some officers, including Major Herbert Smith, went to the infantry school at Fort Benning to learn combat tactics. Pearl Harbor abruptly ended Stenberg's dream of putting in a year and returning home to resume his life. On December 31, 1941, the Army informed all one-year soldiers that they were now obligated to serve for the duration of the conflict, plus 6 months. Few soldiers were pleased, but now, instead of griping, they spoke of exacting revenge on the yellow bastards and making quick work of the war. "Remember Pearl Harbor" became their battle cry. Japan's December 7th assault on Pearl Harbor decimated the Pacific Fleet, killed or wounded over 3,500 men, and sent shockwaves through America. In Japan, the excited voices of newsmen crackled over radios, "The war with America has begun." Throughout the day, stations across Japan played military songs, including the inspirational Battleship March. At dawn on the same day, the Imperial Army landed at Kota Baru on the east coast of the Malay Peninsula, beginning its takeover of Southeast Asia. The day after Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt asked Congress to declare war on Japan. Winston Churchill, for one, was relieved. He exclaimed that he was well content with the news. The U.S. had been forced to enter a war it had long resisted. America geared up at a furious pace. Across the country, men by the thousands no longer waited to be drafted. Many did not even know where Pearl Harbor was. They knew, though, that the Japanese had just bombed American soil. The Selective Service cracked down on conscientious objectors, and the Attorney General rounded up alleged Axis sympathizers. Meanwhile, President Roosevelt issued his infamous Executive Order 9066. By August, anyone who was 1/16th Japanese, possessing at least one Japanese grandparent, a total of 120,000 people, was interned. By January 1, 1942, the United States would surpass Germany as the world's largest producer of planes. Thousands of defense plants were being built. Shipyards were running around the clock. America firsters, who, advocating isolationism, had opposed entry into the war, no longer had an ideological leg to stand on. The American public supported strict rationing programs, which included limits on paper, shoes, silk, butter, milk, canned goods, meat, and fuel oil. "Use it up, wear it out, make it do or do without," was a slogan indicative of the kinds of sacrifices that Americans were willing to make. People cultivated victory gardens, drove at a victory speed of 35 miles per hour to conserve gas, and organized scrap drives with slogans like "Slap the Jap with the Scrap," "Hit Hitler with the Junk." Bing Crosby sang a song called "Junk Will Win the War." When the War Production Board, WPB, asked for 4 million tons of scrap metal to be gathered in 2 months, people responded with 5 million tons in 3 weeks. The WPB organized rubber drives and paper drives. The Farm Security Administration began a program called An Acre for a Soldier. The profit on that acre was used to buy canteens and other essentials for servicemen. Overnight, apathy had turned into fervent patriotism. By mid-February 1942, concerns about a Japanese follow-up attack had quieted. The men of the 32nd were back at Camp Livingston, preparing to go north to Fort Devens, Massachusetts, by special troop train. At this point, Churchill, Roosevelt, Curtin, and Marshall had not yet struck their deal to send the 32nd to Australia. The plan was to ship the division to Northern Ireland. In fact, its 107th Engineer Battalion was already on its way. But only 6 weeks after arriving at Fort Devens, the 32nd was getting ready to move again. Few of the men knew what was in the works. What they did know was that they were no longer headed for Europe. Catherine Hobson Bailey, wife of Lieutenant Clady Bailey, had driven to Fort Devens to see her husband off. Bailey, who had been the executive officer of Yastrzemski, Stenberg, and DiMaggio's G Company, was now its commander. Earning the respect of the men of Company G had not been easy for Bailey when he reported to Camp Livingston in April 1941. The first strike against him was that he was an ROTC officer. National Guard units were insular groups, made up of men whose friendships often dated back to high school, even grade school. National Guardsmen were not very accepting of outsiders, especially new officers. The second strike was that Bailey, an Indianan, was an interloper among the tightly knit Muskegon, Michigan men. But Bailey quickly earned the admiration of the men of Company G with a unique combination of charisma, humor, and toughness. As an ROTC second lieutenant, he had done a 2-year stint in the Civilian Conservation Corps, and it was in the CCC that Bailey learned how to motivate men. The key was to be right there with them, struggling under a heavy pack, doing the work that they did. When other officers enjoyed the privilege of riding in jeeps to training areas, Bailey chose to walk with his men. When the occasion called for it, he could be decidedly unmilitary. One member of G Company recalls, "He ran a light ship, making weekend camp fun. No inspections, no reveille, just fun and card games." It did not take long for everyone to realize that the company's new lieutenant was a natural. And it did not take them long to give Bailey a nickname. The men of G Company simply called their lieutenant Gus. Gus Bailey was a man from humble roots who made the most of his considerable abilities. A farm boy, he was no stranger to the kind of backbreaking labor that characterized rural life during the Depression. The house he grew up in had no electricity or indoor plumbing. His father, Jim Bailey, was a carpenter who built houses and barns all over the county. His mother, Mamie Bailey, sold eggs and cream and canned with Clady's help. But mostly the farm provided just enough for the family, including a once-a-week Sunday chicken supper. A standout athlete by the time he reached high school, Clady swapped the hard court for the baseball diamond and became a star pitcher on the Indiana University baseball team that won the Big Ten championship in 1934. Bailey was no ordinary jock, though. While at IU, he developed a love of Robert Service's Northwoods ballads. Poetry wasn't something he tried to hide in the Army either.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.